Choir, believe it or not, and have several of those folks out, so we're not going to have the choir today. And so we're just going to do it ourselves, all right? You're not all going to get in the choir loft, but we're going to just have you stay out there, and we'll just be like a big choir this morning, all right? But Happy New Year to you. Good to have you in the service today. How many of you are diehards and you stayed up till midnight? Look at that, all right? Just want to know who'll be sleeping in a little bit. Just wanted to make sure I saw who you were. How many decided it'll get in on its own and you went to bed?
Amen.
Yeah. How many gave up on our Buckeyes and went to bed too? Huh? Yeah, that's well, the sun came up today anyway, didn't it? Amen. And looking forward to what the Lord has for us this year. Going to be a good time together here this morning. Thank you for being in church today and starting not only your week off by being in church on Sunday and the Lord's Day, but starting your year off that way. And that's a good reminder. Just keep Him first all year long, all right? And take your songbook. Let's sing together, okay? Turn over to number 395. Would you go there, please? 395. I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. In my heart there rings a melody. 395. Once you have it, let's stand together. And Bob will lead us today.
I have a song that Jesus gave me. It was sent from heaven above. There never was a sweeter melody. It's a melody of love. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody. There rings a melody of love. I love the Christ who died on Calvary, for He was my sins away. He put within my heart a melody, and I know it's there to stay. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody with heaven's harmony. In my heart there rings a melody, there rings a melody of love. 'Twill be my endless name in glory.
Great singing, and let's have a word of prayer together, shall we? Father, we thank You for today. Thank You for another opportunity for us to gather together. Thank You, Lord, for a brand new year, and Lord, an opportunity for a new beginning and a new start. And Lord, we're thankful for each one that's made their way here this morning. I'm praying for those this morning, Lord, that are not feeling well. You'd put Your healing touch upon them, please. Raise them up to be back with us very soon. And Lord, thank You for the health and strength You've given to us to be here this morning. And Lord, I pray as we bow before You here at the beginning of our service that this service will be what You would desire it to be, that You would use it in each one of our hearts and lives. Lord, set us in the right direction for the coming year. If You tarry, You're coming, and we get the year of 2017 in, Lord, I pray that it will be a year that will be honoring and pleasing to You. Lord, bless this service today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, you may be seated.
Let's turn to number 311 in your hymnal. 311, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Let's sing that first together.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His trodden forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language continually dwell. I'm redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I.
On that last, I know I shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight.
Now, listen carefully. We have some announcements for you. And today's schedule, we'll be back tonight at 5:30 for the evening service. And this will be a little bit different this evening. We'll have our service, and but we will also be revealing the theme for 2017. And we'll unveil that. We'll give you the church calendar for the coming year with the theme on it. We'll have time of testimony and praise. Some of the things we normally do on New Year's Eve, but we didn't get to do it last night, and so we'll incorporate some of that in. And then if you signed up downstairs, if you haven't, still sign up today. You bring your food in over to the fellowship hall, and we'll eat after the service. And while we're over there eating, we'll show the year in review from 2016. We have several hundred pictures to go through, and we'll get to relive some of the wonderful blessings that the Lord gave us in 2016 as we get to enjoy some food and fellowship after the service tonight. So it's a great, great time together this evening. So come on out and enjoy that with us tonight. You'll have a great time together, okay? Remember the time, 5:30 for the evening service, okay? If you come at 6:30, you're going to miss it. All right, so be a little bit earlier tonight. Then the Grove City School of the Bible, the sign up for that, that meets on Tuesday evenings from 7 to 9:30. Three courses being offered this year, and it's teaching the Bible. And by the way, that's a great course. If you're involved in our children's church or you're involved in Sunday school class, any way of teaching the Bible at all, you ought to go to that class. You ought to see it. If you can't pay for it, you see Bob Wallace. He'll take care of it for you. And thank you. He's shaking his head. He's all right with that. And if he has a problem, his wife will take care of that, okay? And you just do that. But seriously, what a great help that would be. And take advantage of that. That's a great opportunity. And then another class they're having is the Christian home. What makes a Christian home? Is your home just like everybody else's home? Or is it a Christian home? Well, what makes it a Christian home? You ought to find out. Great class. Boy, these are good. And then the other one is a survey of the New Testament, so you can get to know the Word of God, get to know the book that God gave to you. And Brother Xavier is teaching that class. Is that right? Survey of the New Testament. And then the other one's a Christian home and teaching the Bible. So don't miss out on these opportunities. There's a sign-up sheet down there. Just sign up. The reason we have to get this going, the first class, I think, is January 24th, but we got to order the material, and we want to make sure we have enough for everybody who wants to come. So get your name on that list, and Brother Moreland will get that material ordered this week from the School of the Bible. All right? A couple just business things now that we want to... Oh, I want to also let you know, Saturday evening at 5 o'clock is the workers' dinner and meeting, okay? If you're involved in the ministries here at Bible Baptist Church, or you're not, but you ought to be, then you come Saturday evening, all right? 5 o'clock, there's a sign-up sheet for that down there. Follow the instructions. We have a nice meal together. And then we come in here and get some teaching and some challenging done here, and it's a great, great night. And get involved, okay? And you'll be glad. You're happy in the service of the King, and so you're happy when you're serving. So get involved and be serving the Lord. That's this Saturday at 5 o'clock. Now, a couple things. We some of you got together and helped put the decorations up for Christmas. Now we need some folks to help get the decorations down from Christmas, okay? We thought about doing it tomorrow, But I thought maybe folks may want to stay this evening and get them all done, and then you don't have to come tomorrow at all. Is there anybody that might be willing tonight after the activities to just get this down and put back in the totes and get it ready to be put away? Who could help with that? Alan will help. Ann? Okay. All right, Brother Moreland. Brother Parrish, good. Great. Thank you. If you guys can do that, just remember that after the service tonight. I'll let my wife know that. That'll be a blessing. Okay? Great. Now, one other order of business here. We want to make sure we update our prayer bulletin on Wednesday nights, okay? Once a year, we have to just get that updated. I have some 3x5 cards here. If you have someone on that list, whether it's under salvation or cancer or health list or whatever it is that you have a name on that list and you want it to stay on that list, then you need to put that name on here and turn it in. Just put the card in the offering when it goes by today, okay? If we don't get anything back, then that name will come off our list, okay? So to remain on, you want to fill a card out and get that in. So why don't you, a couple of you guys, grab this, Brother Danny and Brother Bill. Just put your hand up if you need a card that you can put the name and what it's under, whether it's salvation or health or cancer or whatever it may be, military service, whatever it might be. You put that on there. If you want to add somebody in that's not on there, just go ahead and put it on that card. And those are the names that will go on our prayer list on Wednesday night, okay? And we try to purge that out once a year and keep it up to date, okay? All right. Everybody doing that? Very good. Well, let's take a moment now. Let's welcome any guests we have with us in the service. We're always glad when folks visit, especially when you visit on New Year's Day. And anybody here today for the very first time? We can find out who you are and where you're from. Brother Neil, you got some guests with you? Julius and Jaden. Good. Good to have you, fellas. Thank you for being here. Great. All right. And over here, did I see a hand over here? Right here? Okay. And you are? Natalie, good to have you this morning. Natalie, where are you from? From here? Grove City? Columbus? Okay, great. Good to have you this morning. Great. And you have some children with you. Wonderful. Thank you for coming today. Glad you're here this morning. Wonderful. Starting the new year off right. All right. The usher is going to hand you a card to fill out. If you take just a moment and fill that card out, we'd appreciate you doing that. And we'll have a record of your visit with us. If when the offering goes by, you just drop that card in the offering plate if you would. Keep the pen as our gift to you for coming. All right, we're glad you're here this morning. Let's give these folks a warm welcome, shall we?
Would you turn with me to number 285 in your bulletin, or in your hymnal? I'm sorry, 285, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Let's sing that first together. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace in mind, leaning on the everlasting arm. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arm. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arm. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Children, you can be dismissed to junior church. Children, you're dismissed to junior church as we sing that last together. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms, I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. I'm leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, singing this morning. Let's go over to 275, back a few. 275, it is well with my soul. Would you stand with me as you find 275? On that first all together.
When peace like a river attends.
Somebody feel welcome without getting home sick, and we'll come back and sing that last together. Thank you. is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when the faith shall be sight. Let's sing that last together. And Lord, haste the day when the faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound and the Lord shall descend. Even so,
amen. Be seated. Great singing this morning. That's good. One way for it to be well with your soul is to not rob God of his tithe. Amen. Give the Lord what rightfully belongs to him, and that's the way to live. And that's the way to enjoy God's blessing. God said if you prove him, he can open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. Won't be room enough to receive it. And just trust God about that. And if you'll do that all year long in 2017, you'll have a prosperous 2017. And God will take care of you. And there's others who would testify to that in this room. God has bountifully cared for them because they faithfully give the Lord what's his. All right? Let's pray. We'll ask God's blessing on our offering this morning. Brother Abrams, lead us in our prayer.
Good morning. Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to come before you once again. And Lord, we ask that you bless the service, bless the offering, bless the message it has brought, and may every soul receive what is need been brought to today. And Lord, we all know that there's a God-shaped hole in every heart that only Jesus can fill. And Lord, let us have that spot filled today, and bless our pastor as he brings the message. And put him aside and let God speak through him. In Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. Thank you.
Take your Bible this morning, if you would, please, to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5, please, for our scripture reading. Ephesians and chapter 5. We're going to read verses 15 through 20. Verses 15 through 20. And we'll read the verses responsively. We'll begin together on 15, and I'll read 16, alternating till we end on verse number 20. As our custom is, let's stand together to read the scripture. All of us standing, please, to read God's word. And let's begin together on verse 15 of Ephesians chapter 5. Ready? See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore, be not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Let's read 20 together also. Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the good music today. Thank you for the great congregational singing we've heard. And Lord, it's a joy to be together with the people of God on the first day of a new year. And Lord, it's just seems like it's the way it ought to be. Thank you for each one that's here. Thank you, Lord, for the good spirit that's in this place this morning. We pray your blessing on the special as it's sung, and that you'll make our hearts ready to receive the truth from your word today. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best Lord, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my vision, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only, first in my heart. I, King of heaven, my treasure thou art. I, King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joys, O Bridegroom Son. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision, O ruler of all.
Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer this morning, and Lord, we're asking you to open our understanding as we look into the Word today. Lord, I want to thank you again for the Bible. Thank you, Lord, for preserving your Word that we hold in our hands, copies of it today. And Lord, I'm praying you'll use the Word in our lives this morning, that each of us would listen carefully to what the Spirit would say to each one of us individually. We'd not miss what you have for us here on this first Sunday morning of 2017, a brand new year. Lord, I pray each of us would have ears to hear what the Spirit would say to each of us this morning. Help me as I bring the truth today, and please help each individual as they listen. May your will be accomplished in our lives, and I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's a time of year when people make resolutions. How many of you sit down and make New Year's resolutions? Anybody do that? Oh, not very many. Okay. And that's whether you call them goals or resolutions or things you're going to do differently. I think you ought to set goals. I know this, if you aim at nothing, you hit it every time. And so you need to set some goals about things you can do. I came across the list of, they compiled through the years, the top 10 New Year's resolutions. And number one was to spend more time with family and friends. Number two was to fit in fitness. Get in shape, okay? Round isn't a shape, okay? And take care of your health, exercise, all right? Another one was three, tame the bulge, lose weight. Four was quit smoking. That's a good one. And the fifth resolution was enjoy life more. They didn't say how they're going to do that, but that's what they put. Six was quit drinking. Well, hopefully that's not a problem, but if it is, it'd be a good time to quit. Seven, get out of debt. That made the top 10. How about that? And that means you have to say no to yourself on some things and say, I can't do that. Number eight, learn something new. I know you're thinking, I got enough to do already. Why would I learn something new, right? Learn something new. Number nine, help others. Help others. That's good. Number 10, get organized. I know you're thinking, I haven't been organized this far. Why start now? But get organized. Those are the top 10. But did you notice something in those top 10 resolutions? Nothing about God. Nothing about the Lord at all. Nothing, no spiritual improvement there anywhere. Nothing to do with their spiritual progress. And by the way, it's not unusual because God's not included in many people's lives. Just not part of the equation. And I believe the Bible teaches that God ought to be included in every area of our life. Every aspect of our life. God is to be, we are to in all our ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct our path. Now, in Ephesians 5, where your Bible's open this morning, there's some practical advice here. We taught in Sunday school this morning about the book of Romans and how the first 11 chapters are doctrinal, and then chapter 12 through 16 are very practical. In other words, it's how we live out the doctrines of the first 11 chapters. Ephesians is set up much the same way. The first three chapters of Ephesians are very doctrinal. And give us our position in Christ and what we have in Christ and all the spiritual blessings that we have in Christ. And then chapters 4, 5, and 6 are very practical. How we live out that doctrine. How we live out those truths. Same principle is laid out in the book of Romans. And here in Ephesians 5 are some very practical things that I think we could take these three principles and apply them to 2017. These three principles, and we apply them to have a prosperous 2017. Not just in our eyes, or not just in man's eyes, but in God's eyes. Because we're following God's precepts here, and God's principles. And here they are. We start with number one, verse number 15, where the Bible says, "See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Be ye not unwise, wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. And I'm going to sum all that up by simply saying, here's the first thing you do is you be careful. Be careful. That's circumspectly is talking about being careful in how we live, careful in the way we live. Be careful with your time. Redeeming the time means buy up the time. We have all these gadgets that people thought would give us more time, and all they do is take up more of our time. And people have more today than ever before. People say, I just don't have the time to do it. I just am so busy. And God says, let's be careful to redeem the time. Let's be careful to not be unwise about the will of the Lord. What does God want me to do? How does God want me to live? How does God want me to approach the day that I'm approaching? I need to seek God's will in everything. Don't be unwise. Be understanding what the will of the Lord is. What does God want for me in my life? There's four horsemen of the accident prone is what I read, and it is this: hurry, worry, multitasking, and stress. Hurry, worry, multitasking, and stress. That causes us to be accident prone. One fella, this guy, Steve Rowe was his name. These are all things, self-induced injuries that he has done to himself. Are you ready? Fractured skull, torn rotator cuff, shattered fingers, broken wrist, fractured elbow, torn muscle, sulfuric acid burns, self-stabbings, multiple broken noses, and then a ruptured tendon in his ankle. And this guy is only 46 years old. He's a patent attorney in Madison, Wisconsin, and about his ruptured tendon in his ankle, he said, I don't know. He said, I didn't trip or anything. I'm just walking down the hall in a hurry, and I went around the corner, and suddenly it felt like someone hit me in the ankle with a baseball bat. And down he went. It's hurry, worry, multitasking, and stress lead to accidents. But wait a minute. Does that happen just in the physical realm, or does that happen in the spiritual realm too? How often are we in a hurry when it comes to wanting to spend time with God? Are we worrying and our mind goes other places when we should be focusing on the Lord? Are we want to read the Bible, but we want to do other things too, so we just will play it and listen to it so we can do other things. We call it multitasking, or you could call it not focusing on any one thing. Okay? You think about what goes on. We're not as spiritually minded as we ought to be. Hello? We're not as spiritually minded as we ought to be. Somebody says, oh, I'm concerned about being so heavenly minded, I won't be any earthly good. I wouldn't worry about that at all. Trust me. I've not run into many of those in my 34 years of being in the ministry. I've run into a whole lot of people that were so earthly minded they weren't any heavenly good. Colossians chapter 3, you're in Ephesians. Just turn to your right there. You go Philippians, and then go past Philippians, you'll see Colossians. Look at Colossians chapter 3 with me, will you? Notice verse number 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. So we set our affection on things above, not on things on the earth. We were to keep our focus on Christ. Who's our life? Hey, it's not Ohio State. Aren't you glad? Huh? No. Listen, Christ is our life. And we keep our focus on things above, not on things on the earth. And the way to keep your focus on things above is to keep your focus on Jesus Christ. Because He is above. And He will keep our focus where it needs to be. Many of you remember several years ago, Toyota had a recall of their about 4 million cars because the accelerator would stick. Now, for some of you, that was just fine. But for some people, that's a problem. And they didn't want that sticking there, and you would get stuck to the floor. And it was a really rough time for Toyota. It was a real blow to their ego and their self-proclaimed, you know, pride as being a world's largest automaker. And sometimes, you know, you maybe spiritually we need to have a recall. And God would look at our lives and say, maybe you have some issues that the manufacturer needs to work on. Huh? Instead of ignoring it and acting like there's not a problem. Okay? And so we have to ask God to do something. If something's not functioning properly and we're not doing what we ought to be doing, then we need to let God get involved and we need to allow God to make the changes in us that need to change. Listen, if you don't change anything, nothing's going to change. That's brilliant, isn't it? Huh? But you know what I mean? We think we'll just keep doing everything the way we always do it and then things will come out different this time. It won't happen. It won't work that way. Something has to change, and you have to ask God to bring about the change. He is a changing agent in our lives, and He'll use the Word of God to change us. And so we have to use our time wisely. We have to redeem the time. We have to listen to God's warnings when He puts them up. I read about a guy who was delivering a computer to an office, and he was going to cut through the alley and come in behind the store, and there was a sign, a handwritten sign, that said, "Do not enter, alley blocked," and he ignored it and drove in anyway. And sure enough, he said, I got about halfway back there, and there was a tree laying across the alley. He said, and of course, it was with great difficulty. I had to try to maneuver and get the truck turned around and get back out. And he said, as I got back out to the main road to get back on the road to come around to the front, there was another handmade sign facing the other way that said, "I told you so." Huh? How many times have you been warned or God given you a sign and you ignored it only to see the other sign that said, "I told you so. I told you so." That's what the Bible says. Don't be unwise, but be understanding what the will of the Lord is. You understand what God wants you to do. And God, and ever had God tell you something and you didn't listen so well? Couldn't that be different in 2017? Couldn't that be something you'd say, I think I'll listen to God in 2017? Be careful in the way you live. Live circumspectly. Use your time for God. Use your time for the Lord. Be aware. That's the only, listen, it's the only, you get those minutes, I forget how many there are, 86,400 some seconds in a day, and you get those deposited into your account every single day. The problem is, if you don't spend it all, you don't carry any over to the next day. If I gave you 86,000 some dollars every day and said, now you'll get another 86,000 tomorrow, but you have to spend all of that today. How many of you think you'd spend it all? Yeah. Cynthia Lynn said, shopping, here I come. Huh? Yeah. Yeah. You'd say, I'd spend it because I want another 86,000 next day. Hey, we get that every day, but it's in seconds, not money. Do we redeem the time? Do we use the time? Make sure we redeem the time. Make sure we're being careful with how we live. Then the second thing he gives us over in Ephesians 5 is verse number 18. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now I'm going to put this under this two words, be thoughtful. Now you're going to see how that fits into the Spirit, because the Spirit will help us think of others, not ourselves. And we ought to be, by the way, we ought to be mindful that the Spirit of God lives in us. We mentioned in Sunday school how Paul struggled in Romans 7 with I don't want to do this, and I do this, and I don't want to do that, and I don't want to do this, and I submit, I'm sinful, and I, oh, wretched man that I am. Who's going to deliver me? And then he realizes it's Jesus Christ. And then you go to Romans chapter 8, and it's all about the Spirit, and the Spirit, and the Spirit, and the Spirit. And it's not about I anymore at all. And it's all about the Spirit of God. You're not going to be mindful of the Spirit and be controlled by self. It'll be an impossibility. Here's an article that says, how to be miserable. Here it is. Ready? Quote, think about yourself. Talk about yourself. Use I as often as possible. Mirror yourself continually in the opinion of others. Listen greedily to what people say about you. Expect to be appreciated. Be suspicious. Be jealous. Be envious. Be sensitive to slights and criticisms. Never forgive a criticism. Trust no one but yourself. Insist on consideration and respect. Demand everyone agree with your views on everything. Sulk if people are not grateful to you for a favor when you show them. Never forget a service you've given. Shirk your duties if you can. And do as little as possible for others. There you go. If you want to have a miserable new year, you just got the formula right there. Now, don't say anything. Don't raise your hand. Don't poke anybody. But how many of those things in that list have you been guilty of? You can get caught up. It's so easy for us to get caught up in ourselves if we don't watch it. We get so self-focused, we forget about anybody else. Roy De Lamont was a chaplain at a Bible college in Georgia. He preached the shortest sermon in the college's history. He had a long title. In fact, the title was longer than the sermon. Okay? His title was this: what does Christ answer when we ask, Lord, what's in this for me? So here's the title: what does Christ answer when we ask, Lord, what's in this for me? And so here's the complete content of his sermon. One word. Nothing. Nothing. He explained that his sermon was meant to help the students understand they're in such a give me gospel. What's in it for me? Mentality. That they ask him, how long did it take you to prepare that sermon? He said, 25 years. 25 years. Most people are only interested in what they can get, not what they can give. Isn't that what Brother John was hitting on Wednesday night? God, I have you in here, so God, you can give me money, you can give me health, you give me a nice car, give me a good house, give me. And if God doesn't give me all these things, I don't need God. Happens all the time. People get disillusioned and they quit. Nobody thinks about what we're supposed to be giving to God. We only think about what God's supposed to be giving to us. He read it Wednesday night. Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of yourself. Huh. Oh. I'm glad none of you said amen when I said that. No. All to the glory of God. Glory means to put in a good light or to put in a good opinion. So you do all that we do so that people have a good opinion about God. But how often do we do things so people have a good opinion about us? And the focus is on us. It's not on others. And it's certainly not on God. Look at, you're in Ephesians. Turn to your right there to the book of Galatians. I'm sorry, to your left to the Galatians. Galatians, just the book right before Ephesians. Look at Galatians 5. Notice with me verse 13. Notice Galatians 5, 13. For brethren, ye have been called unto liberty. Only use not your liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love do what? Serve one another. What should you do, church? Serve one another. By love, you serve one another. What's love? Willingly, sacrificially giving yourself for the benefit of others with no thought of return. You do that for others. Look at chapter 6 and verse 2. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. Look at verse 9. Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them who are of the household of faith. Over and over again, you see the admonition, hey, you're to be thinking, you're to be thoughtful of other people. The Christian life isn't about you. It's not about I. Jesus, what are the two greatest commandments? Well, the first is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. But the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. You're not going to, listen, it's like unto loving God as you have to love others too. It didn't say, well, you know, you got to love yourself. God didn't say that. He said, you're going to love your neighbor. Those two commandments are the greatest. Listen, we're all in 2017. You're either going to be self-centered or you're going to be spirit-controlled. That's going to be your decision. That's going to be your choice. And whenever you get to that list of misery that we listed earlier, how to be miserable, and you start looking at that in your life and you see these things, I hope the Spirit of God would arrest you and say, hey, who are you thinking about right now? And you'd have to admit, I'm thinking about me. I'm not thinking about anybody else. I'm just thinking about me. I'm self-centered, and I need to be spirit-centered, spirit-focused, focused on the Spirit of God. And you do that, by the way, you'll never be filled with the Spirit if you're not filled with His Word. If you want to have a Spirit-led life and you want to have a Spirit-filled life, you want to have a Spirit-controlled life, then you must make much of the Bible. The words that I speak unto you, Jesus says, they are Spirit and they are life. Holy men of old spake as they were moved by the Spirit of God. These are His words. And so He'll guide you and He'll lead you with His Word. When you let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly, you're yielding to the Spirit of God. You're allowing the Spirit of God to dwell in you richly. You neglect the Bible, you'll be neglecting the Spirit of God in your life. Okay? And so be thoughtful. Be thoughtful. The Spirit of God will help you. And if you're mindful of Him, He'll control your life. If you're mindful of Him and you yield to Him, He'll control your life. So he said, first principle, first thing is be careful. Second thing is be thoughtful. There's a third one. All right, Ephesians 5, verse number 19. Speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The third one is simply be thankful. You know, living a grateful life will help you. People who are not aware of their blessings are not very thankful. An Associated Press did a poll where Nearly 70% of the people questioned said they thought people were ruder today than they were 30 years ago. They said that the generation that came of age in the 60s and 70s and are now parents, they don't stress the importance of manners. A whopping 93% of the people polled in the Associated Press poll faulted parents for not teaching their children well. And by the way, that's true. The problem we have with crime in America, the problem we have with rioters and people throwing tantrums when they don't get their way, and people who want to loot stores and have all kinds. Listen, that stems from a child who was allowed to throw a tantrum when they were at home. And a child that was allowed to get his own way and didn't have a parent there to say, we're not doing that. A parent, hey, how many of you, let me take a poll. This will be my unofficial poll, okay? All right? New Year's Day poll right here. How many had a mom or a dad that said, if you want to cry, I'll give you something to cry about? Huh? Oh. How did you ever turn out? Huh? How'd you ever make it? Huh? You poor thing. Look, you learned. I don't think it's worth crying over this. Okay, that's not worth it, and you made some decisions. Be careful. You have to be, but you have to ask yourself this. Listen, I don't want us just to think about situations or people where we see where parents maybe didn't do the job. But listen, I want you to think about: am I ever rude? I've been in restaurants before with Christians and been embarrassed at how rude they'll be to a waiter or waitress when maybe they're just overwhelmed. Maybe someone didn't show up for work and they've got four more tables than what they normally would have, and it's just they're just trying to get to everybody. And we don't have any consideration for that. And I'm embarrassed sometimes at how rude Christians can be. If that's your case and you treat somebody that way, don't put a track on the table. At least not with our church name on it. Do you say thank you? Do you show appreciation? Do you show gratitude? One lost art is a thank you note. Somebody does something nice for you, you ought to write them a note. That's showing appreciation. By the way, teach your children that. Christmas was just over. They got gifts at Christmas. Got to teach them to write thank you notes. Express gratitude. Now notice what he says. Giving thanks always for all things. I don't think there's any holes in there, is there? There's nothing to slip through the cracks, is there? Giving thanks always for all things. And listen, while we can express that gratitude to others, and we ought to learn to be appreciative for what we get. You know, I'll never forget years ago at a Bible school, and we get it sometimes with kids today. You know, they won a nightly prize, and the pastor handed it to the kid, and kid says, I already got two of these at home. So, okay, here, you want one of these? No, I got one of those too. Okay, and he's trying to find something this kid doesn't have. See, not have any gratitude, any word, any appreciation for what someone wants to give to you. Years ago, and I'll help you with something, I hope. There are times you may get a gift, you may receive something that you can't use or you don't really care for. You know, you don't, okay, it's Christmas and you give Brother Xavier a hairbrush. All right? And now that'd be kind of silly, you know? I mean, but you know what he would do? He would receive it and be gracious and say, well, thank you so much. And then he'd wrap it up and give it to his wife. But no, he would, amen? But years ago, had a couple, they were just new, and it wasn't at this church, but they were just brand new, and they were new Christians, This was back when they had records. Date myself a little bit, all right? And some of you younger people are mostly out, but for those of you who don't know, records, they're like big CDs, only they're a big one. And an album, you know, and it was at that time a contemporary singer that they liked. I don't think I have a contemporary bone in my body, okay? But I, you know, when they gave it to me, you know what I did? I said, thanked them for it. I opened it up, we looked at it, said, okay, and here it is. I never did listen to it, never did play it, but I thanked them and wrote them a nice note for their thoughtfulness and their kindness to think of us and want to give us a gift, okay? That's just be gracious and express thanks. But listen, here, notice what it says in verse 20, giving thanks always for all things unto God. Now, I want you to ask yourself this question. Have I ever been unthankful to God? Have I ever been rude to God? I want you to turn back to Psalm 77. Would you look there with me, please? Psalm 77. You're not in a hurry, are you? I mean, you got nowhere to go today. It's January 1st, all right? Some of you midnighters, you're a little tired right now, but you'll be all right. You think God pays attention to us when we pray? You think God pays attention to us when we praise Him and when we thank Him? You think God's listening? You think a God that says that I can number the hairs on your head is not going to listen when we talk? When we give our petition to Him? Psalm 77, notice verse number 3, David says, I remembered God and was troubled. Now notice this, I complained and my spirit was Selah. You know what Selah means? Selah means it's a musical rest. And what it means when you write the Psalms is, whenever you see a Selah there, you ought to say in your mind, stop and think about that. Pull over and park there a while, okay? Whatever phrase you want to use. That means, think about it. Listen, notice what he said. When I complained, my spirit was overwhelmed. How many times you heard somebody say, I'm just overwhelmed? One fellow wrote this. I used to think people complained because they had a lot of problems. But now I've come to realize that they have a lot of problems because they complain. Complaining doesn't change anything or make any situation better. It just amplifies the frustration, spreads discontent and discord, and really invites the devil to wreak havoc in our lives. Complaining will make you miserable. I complained and my spirit was overwhelmed. All of us are prone to be negative. It's human nature. Negative, the news is negative. The newspapers are negative. Negative stuff sells, you know? But, you know, if you don't think you're negative, you challenge yourself with this. Go all day today and never be negative about anything. Don't say a negative word about somebody. Don't look at the bad side of a situation. Say, how come that guy's going so slow? How come he turned that way? How come he's driving this? Don't say anything like, be positive all the way through. Boy, you'll catch yourself just how many negative things flow out. And how often do we just complain? Go to the New Testament. Go with me to the book of Philippians. Philippians chapter 2. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, right after the book of Ephesians. Ephesians tells us something about believers. Notice verse 13. The Bible says, it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of His good pleasure. All right, now look at me. You're saved, you know Christ your Savior, you're on your way to heaven. Who is at work in your life? Yeah, God is at work. And He's working in you, both to will and to do of His good pleasure. So verse 14 follows verse 13. What's it say? Do all things without murmurings and disputings. If it's God that's at work and God that's working in me, why am I complaining? Why am I murmuring and disputing? You know what that is? That's complaining. I'm not being grateful. I'm not being thankful. You think God listens to that? He absolutely listens to that. He says, so you do it without complaining. Why? Verse 15, that ye may be blameless, harmless, the sons of God without rebuke, in the midst of a crooked and perverse complaining nation. My added the complaining. Among whom ye shine as lights in the world. Because you know what, you know what getting you noticed is when you do, when you go through life and you don't complain about it. People will notice you. You'll shine like a light in a dark room. You know what hurts your testimony more than anything else? Griping and complaining. And you're really griping and complaining. We're really doing it against God. It doesn't help anything. Wouldn't you much rather hear somebody say, praise the Lord, or bless God, than complain or murmur? 1 Thessalonians 5:18, in everything give thanks. Why? For this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Oh, I wish I knew the will of God. Well, I know part of it right there. Why don't you start right there with that one? It's the will of God in everything we give thanks. For this is the will of God. I'm convinced a grateful, thankful person is going to live a better life and be blessed with a better life than someone who's complaining. And I know you'll have a better testimony. Would you be quick to praise Him this year? For everything He does. I mean, as soon as you realize God's done something, thank Him for that. We are good at asking and asking and asking, and then when we get it, we kind of say, thanks, God. If we even do that. A lot of times we ask, and ask, and when it finally comes through or we get a blessing from God, and you know what we do? Bill, guess what? Man, you won't believe it. I got this. Or I got that. Or Lindy, I got this. And we tell everybody else, and we never get alone and just tell God, thank you. Thank you. Give gratitude to God. Give. And by the way, when you get that cultivated in you, you'll want to give gratitude to others. Ronald Reagan was a great president and loved by many people. In fact, won over a lot of even critics of his day. Ronald Reagan, he made it a habit. This is an amazing thing to me. He was president of the United States. I imagine as a president, you're kind of busy. Just guessing. And if I remember correctly, it was his habit, and I'm trying to remember the exact number, but it was somewhere between 12 and 20 thank you notes he wrote every single day. Cultivating gratitude. How many people do you think it would make their day to get a thank you note from the President of the United States? And he was grateful for just things people did for him. He'd get a personal note of thanks from the President. Now, I suppose if he could find time to write that many thank you notes, I suppose we could find time to write a couple. I realize he's not as busy as we are. But we could cultivate that thankfulness and be thankful. One lady said, Last year I called my parents to wish them a happy new year, and Dad answered the phone. And I said, well, Dad, what's your New Year's resolution? He said, my New Year's resolution is to make your mother as happy as I can all year long. Boy, how many ladies like that resolution, huh? Yeah. She said, then my mom got on the phone. And I said, Mom, what's your resolution? She said, my resolution is to see to it that your dad keeps his resolution. Yeah. I know this. I know that what God would like to see us keep are these resolutions. That we would be careful. That we would be careful how we live our lives. That we'd be careful to redeem the time and careful to be understanding what the will of the Lord is. That we would be thoughtful of the Spirit of God who dwells in us and allow Him to control us and not get wrapped up in ourselves. And that we would be thankful. Thanking others for what they do for us, but mostly thanking God for what He's doing in us and through us. Let's be careful. Let's be thoughtful. Let's be thankful. Let's pray together, shall we? Father, take the truth now this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the attention of everyone here today. Lord, thank you for the plainness of your word as we look into the scripture this morning. And Lord, just some very practical things we drew out of the book of Ephesians that I think would help us in the coming year. Things that I think are profound, but yet they're simple enough that we can remember them. And Holy Spirit, I pray you would remind us of these things as we set out on a brand new 365 days. And Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us to be careful, to be thoughtful, and to be thankful. Father, I pray that if there are any here this morning and they've never received Christ as their Savior, that the best way they could start off a new year is with new life, eternal life in Jesus Christ. If they've never placed their faith in Him for salvation, that they would put their faith in Jesus today as their Savior. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, and I'll finish the prayer in just a moment. But right now, just between you and God, on January the 1st, 2017, no one's looking. I wonder how many in the room would say, Pastor, I start out this year knowing that Jesus is my Savior, knowing that my faith is in Christ alone for my eternal life. And I know that if something happened to me today and I died, I'd go to heaven. I'm confident of that. Because my faith is in Jesus. Here's my hand as a testimony. Would you slip it up for a moment that I may see it? I know that I'm saved. All right, you may put it down. You're here today and would say, Pastor, I don't know that for sure. I don't know if I died, I'd go to heaven or if I'd go to hell. But I'd like to know that. Would you let me pray for you? I'll not embarrass you or call you out, but I'll remember you in prayer. Would you slip your hand up and say, Pastor, pray for me this morning? I'm not sure if I died, I'd go to heaven. I appreciate you praying for me. Just slip it up and put it back down. I'll see it. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else this morning? All right. The message was to believers today. Three simple principles from Ephesians chapter 5. I wonder how many believers here today would say, Preacher, the Spirit of God dealt with my heart this morning. And by His grace and with His help, I'm going to live by those principles this year. I'm going to ask Him to remind me of those principles every day that I can have a prosperous 2017 in God's sight. Pastor, the Lord spoke to my heart this morning. Pray for me today. Would you slip your hand up, Christian? Amen. Amen. Many hands here this morning. Thank you. You may put them down. In a moment, I'll pray, and then we're going to have our invitation. When I'm through praying, we'll stand to our feet. When we stand to our feet, the pianist will play. Then Brother Bob will sing. If you're not sure this morning, if you died, you go to heaven. You're not sure of eternal life. Then when the instrument begins to play and Bob sings, just slip from your seat, come to the front. We'll have someone who's been trained take a Bible and show you how you can know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Now you can be sure that you'll go to heaven when you die. Christian, the altar is open for you to come and to pray. Whatever God has dealt with your heart about, respond to Him this morning, will you? Father, we thank You for speaking to our hearts today. Thank You, Lord, for decisions that have been made for You this morning. And I pray, God, that You will have Your will and way in every heart. That, Lord, as You have spoken to our hearts, we would respond to You now. Lord, decisions we've made around these altars this morning that would affect us for our rest of our lives as well as into eternity. Lord, have Your own way now in every heart and life, and I'll thank You for it. With your heads bowed, stand to your feet. As you stand to your feet, the pianist will play. As she plays, Bob's going to sing. God has spoken to your heart. Respond to Him this morning, will you please?
Oh, soul, are you weary?
That's right.
And troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, He passed and we follow Him there. Over us sin no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, He promised. Believe Him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, His perfect salvation to tell. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Father, we thank You now for Your goodness to us, and thank You, Lord, for speaking to our hearts this morning. It's been good to be in the house of the Lord today. Thank You for each one that's made their way here. Lord, I pray You'll be with us now as we go our separate ways and watch over us throughout the afternoon. Lord, bring us back this evening for a wonderful time together tonight as we look forward to what You have for us in 2017 and reflect back on Your blessings to us through 2016. Lord, I hope many will be able to make their way back and be with their church family this evening for this special time together. Dismiss us now with Your care and Your blessing. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. 5:30 tonight. Don't forget that. If we could have some fellas help us get tables and chairs set up over in the fellowship hall. I think Children's Church, let them get out. Don't hurt any children in the process, okay? But get the tables and chairs. Four rows of three tables, you know what we're talking about? And get that set up over there. That would be a great help. If we could at least get that set up, that'd be great, fellas. Thank you for doing that. Some of you fellas do that. Got your hand up? Anybody? There's one. There's two. There's three. There's four. There's five. There's six. Good. Okay, good. Got it covered. Thank you for doing that. All right. Then 5:30 tonight. Don't miss that. Boy, it's going to be a great time together, and you get to eat, too. All right? We'll have a good time. Let's sing "I'm So Glad I'm a Part of the Family of God." Brother Bob?
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined hands with Jesus as we travel this sun. For I'm a part of the family of God. Amen. You are dismissed. We'll see you tonight.